Okay, it is just 1 o'clock Eastern time, and I think we're about ready to get started. Good afternoon for all those on the East Coast. I am Sid Goodfriend. I am the founder and chairman of ACP. And it is my great pleasure today to welcome a friend and longtime supporter of ACP to our Wednesday webinar series. Pete Hegseth is the co-host of Fox and Friends Weekend, America's number one cable morning television show. And he also provides commentary among all Fox News and Fox Business programming. Pete is the author of the New York Times bestsellers, American Crusade and In the Arena. And his latest book, here you go, hopefully you guys could all see that. The latest book is called Modern Warriors, which tells real stories about real heroes. And Pete's Modern Warrior series might be could be seen on Fox Nation, which is streaming. Pete is also a combat Army vet who served in Afghanistan and Iraq. He's been awarded 2 Bronze Stars and the Combat Infantryman's Badge. And Pete is still serving as a major in the Army National Guard. We're delighted to have Pete here, but Pete is part of our News Corp and Fox partner group, our corporate partners, now over 100 companies. News Corp and Fox have been partners with ACP since 2009. So we're coming up on 12 years. More than 400 employees of the two companies have been ACP mentors over the years. And of note, even the CEO and chairman himself, Rupert Murdoch, he himself has been an ACP mentor. I've known Pete we've known each other for a number of years, close up to a decade now. And it's wonderful that he's with us today. We can't really offer him a round of applause to get this thing started. So what I'm gonna do is offer the first question and we're going to hear from talk a little bit about his transition and his career post-service. So, well, why don't we get started? So, Pete, ACP is all about assisting our post-9/11 service members as they transition from the military into new roles post their service. So why don't we start this discussion and ask you to talk about your own transition for a bit?
Absolutely. Sid, thank you so much. I'm a huge fan of ACP and the mission from the very beginning. Sitting with you and talking with you back when I lived in New York, which feels like a lifetime ago, and the vision, you quit what you were doing, and you said, I wanna give back to vets, and what you've done is incredible. So congratulations.
Thank you.
Honored to have seen a small part of it early on and watch how it's progressed and the amount of lives that have been changed, precisely because of the question you just asked me. I'll also ask for some grace on the background noise here a little bit. This morning I was at a diner in New Orleans in Jefferson Parish talking to the folks about politics of the day. And now I'm at the New Orleans airport. So if there's flight announcements being made in the background, I apologize in advance, but we should be good to go. Sid, the reason I think I attached so directly to what you're doing with ACP initially is because I had my own transition process that snuck up on me after a couple of active duty tours. I did most of my career in the National Guard, but coming off of three years or more or less of active duty service, and then transitioning back and trying to figure out what I want to do, it sneaks up on you. And I think you're so focused with on your tour or your time being done. Invested in the work that you're doing, the mission that you have and the people that you're around, you sort of end up soaking it all up to the very end. And then in my particular case, then I found myself just a few weeks after having been in combat, effectively in New York City, in Manhattan, in a one bedroom apartment, wondering what comes next. And I did have a job that I was prepared to go to, but a job that was entirely different from what I had been doing and was not connected to a sense of purpose at all. And I had some dark times, and I bet some people on this call can relate to that. Lazy, sleeping in, drinking way too much day after day after day, really disenchanted with the world around me, and the feeling that how do you not understand that there's a war raging halfway across the world, and either you don't know anything about it or you want to tell me how terrible it was. I mean, this is 06, 07, right when a lot of sentiment in the States had turned against the Iraq war. And I had come back actually, while frustrated, actually quite hopeful that if we added more troops and changed the strategy, we could affect a positive outcome there, which is eventually what happened. But you catch yourself almost despising people around you who don't get it. And then you start to go inward. And if you're not reaching out and staying in touch with people who are there, you can get disconnected and turn to other things very quickly, which certainly happened for me. And I didn't, the light didn't come back and the light bulb didn't go off until I was able to sort of rechannel that sense of purpose. I think purpose is really important. It doesn't have to be purpose in an activism sense or a political sense at all. It just means the passion that you have and what you want to do translated at some level into the civilian world, which oftentimes has to do with leadership or serving others or a mission, even if that mission is a bottom line or running a great franchise or managing a team. Focusing in on something that leverages the skills and the passion that you had before is super important. And this was before ACP, but I basically had a couple of people who reached down to me in Manhattan when I lived there and said, I don't know you, but I think your story is kind of interesting. And I'd like to introduce you to a few people. And it was those introductions that opened one door and then another that led me to eventually running a vets organization called Vets for Freedom, which was an Iraq and Afghanistan war veterans organization, advocacy organization. And we were off and running. And I didn't know anything about advocacy and I'd never run a nonprofit before. But and we may end up talking about this, but so many of the skills I had in the military translated into being able to effectively run an organization. So the transition was hard. And that's why ACP makes so much sense to me. Let's create some connections that you otherwise would just never have in the military.
So we have a broad range of people watching this live and we'll be watching it taped on our website and YouTube channel. And the diversity of people who served is just so broad, right? It's broad mm-hmm. in terms of age, work experience, education, ethnicity. I mean, much broader than most companies are, frankly. So it's tough to answer this one question, but let's pick I don't know how old you were when you were getting out, but let's pick a person of that similar demographic.
Yep. 25, 26. Yep.
Okay. Which is a big part of our program. So is there any key advice you might give someone today who's transitioning with a similar type of age and work experience? You know, what are some of the tips that served you well that you may think that other people might not be thinking about as much?
I think the hard part, the one thing that college peers come out with that you don't always come out of the military with is a network, right? A network of people or an alumni association or someone that will introduce you to somebody else. Again, not to just point back to ACP, but something like ACP, or I remember the guy that started Rally Point. Rally Point was sort of a LinkedIn for the military, this idea that you can connect to other people who'd served, other people you served with, because you don't have the alumni association of so-and-so university, but you do have the alumni association of your Marine Corps battalion or the 101st Airborne or other units where a battalion commander who maybe you could have never accessed as an E4 or a platoon leader or an E7, you reach out and say, hey, sir, I was in your battalion or brigade, you know, X number of years ago, and I'd really love to jump on the phone. Once the rank's over and the service time is over, usually those people are chomping at the bit to be in touch with their former troops. And being willing to just reach out and say, can I have a conversation? Because a lot of times for reasons of ranks and reasons of connection and reasons of education, those people have better access to whatever next phase of life they want to go into. So I think it's not easy because you'll go back to where you were from or where you lived into your friends that you had there, many of which will not have the military experience that you do, or they've already jumped into a technical experience. And so they're sort of all the way down the line. I think continuing education ends up being helpful in a skills. It shouldn't have to be as much certification as is often required to redouble the skills that you had in the military. And there's a lot of people fighting to make sure military skills actually translate. But you have to be proactive. It's not going to just happen. And you have to reach out to the networks you have, create the networks that you have, find the people that are doing things you want to do in places you want to do them, and pick up the phone and call them. Leverage the fact that there are tons of patriots in this country. I mean this. The people that helped me were not in the military. They just said, I love the fact that you put the uniform on and I want to do something to help you. It makes them feel good. It makes other people feel good. It's the whole premise of what you do, Sid. Being willing to be proactive and reach out pulls you out of the sort of place you think you're stuck in and gives you a chance to access places and people you didn't think you could otherwise access.
Yeah, it's, we talk, I mean, our entire life at ACP is talking to a wide variety of people. Some are getting out in the next year, some have gotten out in the last three. And people ask, you know, how does this work and how can I maximize my odds of landing a real great job if that's what they're looking for? And I think we've had 20,000 vets and spouses go through our program. And you hit on it just a moment ago. The one thing pretty much every one of those 20,000 successes has had, that they were proactive and they treated looking for the job and thinking about what it is, you know, spending all that time thinking about what's the right career fit for me? What do I want to do? You know, what type of lifestyle choice do I want, right? Do I want to wear a suit? Do I want to sit at a desk? Do I want to work on commission? Right. And all these different things. Do I want regular business hours or am I cool working a weekend if that gives me career opportunities?
Mm-hmm.
The people who have succeeded the best in our program are people that have put in the work to figure out what it is and then how to get there. And so when we see people who are sleeping in, like you were talking about a few moments ago, and maybe, you know, just hanging out with their buddies, you know, you got to treat, I've found you've got to treat looking for a job as a job. You know, you got to get up. And sometimes it happens to even make sense to get up and shave and put on a decent outfit to get yourself focused, as opposed to the guys who are sitting around in their shorts and ripped t-shirts, you know, all day long. And if you treat it like a job and you work at it and you work at the networking and you work at preparing for an interview and think about how you might present, those people succeed so much more easily than people who are just doing this a little bit here and there. So,
absolutely. And there's no playbook on how to do it, right? Setting up a meeting and talking to someone and, hey, grabbing coffee or beer or whatever to pick their brain. Networking is sort of old school in that sense. You just have to be willing to pick up the phone or write the email and ask for the opportunity. And you're going to fail a couple of times and it's not going to work. But then you're going to hit that connection that does. And there's a deeper reservoir of goodwill for vets. I mean, you know this, Sid. So, I mean, I think you can leverage that meaningfully. And it's often very effective.
Yeah. And we tell our vets who are proteges in our program, this will succeed if you take ownership of it. But
that's
don't
right.
expect the mentor to. Right. So I've been very, very blessed sitting here today because of the mentors I had in my career. But very rarely did they say, hey, Sid, let's go out to lunch. It was more like, hey, can I buy you a cup of coffee?
Yes.
Right. Hey, you know, it's Sid again. Hey, remember me? You know, can we spend 20 minutes together? You know, hey, I didn't win that assignment that I was hoping to win. You were in the room or you have any pointers for me? And sometimes asking for.
There was once a guy, Sid, that I really wanted to connect with. He did politically the types of analysis that I wanted to do. And he just blew me off and blew me off and blew me off. He didn't know me from Adam. And finally, I worked so hard on his assistant. And this ultimately led to nothing, by the way. But I worked so hard on his assistant that he gave me time in his car from his place of work to the airport. He gave me 15 minutes in the car with him from place of work to there. That's all I got. Nothing ever came of it. But that could have been the place where if the connection had been struck or he had been interested, it could have led to something. And sometimes vets feel like they're pestering. It takes a lot to get someone to a point where they feel like they're being pestered. People are busy. They have lives. They're doing things. And you are not number one on their priority list. You are number one on your own priority list. You have to keep putting yourself at the top of their inbox. And eventually they'll respond.
The point you just brought up, and we'll get on this in a minute, but when I was a banker many years ago, I had a great boss. And I don't know if he's watching today. Rusty, if you're out there. Rusty was a Navy SEAL and was my boss for many, many years. But I said to him, so how does it work in terms of getting these meetings? And he says, Sid, if you can't get a meeting with the guy that you want, get to know his, what we called him at the time, secretaries. Now you call them administrative assistants or EAs or something like that. Get to know the assistant. She can make your life brutal and she can make it incredibly easy. Make sure you know her name. Make sure you say please and thank you. And make sure that she thinks of you as a real person, not talking down to her. And,
yes.
And if you can do that, you'll stand a better chance. And it sounds like you did that too.
So Sid, anyway, you're right. And I know we're going to get into the media business to that angle, and I can talk, I won't expand on it. I'll keep it short because I know you have other questions, but the same exists in the TV business. You can reach out to a host all day long. You know who really pulls the strings and makes the calls? It's the producers. And getting to know the producers and building those relationships can be far more important.
So we're going to talk, let's talk about TV for a little bit. So when did you know that this is something you wanted to do? I know you're in a whole bunch of things. You're an author, and we talked about the book, and we'll talk about the book at the end a little bit. But, you know, when I think of Pete Hegseth, I think of Pete Hegseth on the weekends at Fox and Friends and behind a camera. And frankly, you're really good at it. Some people would not be. Myself would be one of them. But when did you have a sense that this is something you wanted to do? And then talk a little bit about the journey of what you went through to prepare yourself.
I couldn't tell you the pinpoint of when I knew it's what I wanted to do. I knew I enjoyed it from the beginning, only because for me, it was an extension of fighting for the things I really cared about. I'm like a lot of people on this call, because they served in the military or a military family, I'm a purpose-driven person. I want to feel like I'm fighting for something. And for me, it's my country and the values that I hold. And so it was never, you'll meet a lot of people in TV who the whole thing is about being on TV. And that's the motivation. That's fine. I'm not dismissing that. But for me, it was, hey, my first TV hit ever was with Chris Matthews on Hardball. The only advice I got was from a Marine who'd done TV once. So he was an expert, according to me. That's how much guidance I had. And there were a couple of times he'd done it. So Wade Zirkle, who's a good buddy of mine, Marine Lieutenant, said, you got to lean forward and don't let him cut you off. Lean forward helps with your posture and don't let the host cut you off. Well, I did lean forward, but I got cut off, and I've counted it 37 times in that 6-minute interview with Chris Matthews, because Chris did not agree with me and the show was Hardball, which means I barely got a word in. I mean, it was a total disaster. But you get better by practicing. And I knew I enjoyed the back and forth and the debate. And the reason I felt fortified to talk about it is not that I knew politics, but I knew the battlefield that I'd just come from. So my TV time came from being an advocate for vets and the military and talking about counterinsurgency, the surge, the war, what the troops were facing. I went back multiple times as a reporter with different outlets to walk the ground in the places where I had served, to sort of update my credibility, if you were, to talking about the reality on the ground. And so I got connected to the idea that, and this was before social media, more or less, so not before, but it was in its infancy and not really the potent force that it was today. So being on TV was the way you got the message out about the things that you believed in. And if you wanted to turn the country and the perception of the war, that's what you did. And so I just studied other people that did it well, I did a lot of mimicking of the things that I thought were effective, learning how to not talk too fast, how to pause, how to cut in when you need to, how to be deferential. And ultimately, to me, it comes down to just being yourself in that environment. But it came down to doing enough of that. And you know what it was, honestly, Sid? Years and years and years, years, what ended up being six years of doing any hit anytime when they asked, when no one else would do it for no money. And my other job would be vets advocacy. My other job would be this, would be that. I'd do a full day and all I'd want to do is unwind. And they'd be like, nah, we'd like you in the 11 o'clock hour. And I'd say, all right, let's do it. You know, and taking the slots and the hits that other people would pass over because they didn't want to do it. I just kept doing it to the point where they said, we can rely on Pete. He's good. He's got all these different speeds. And one day they asked me if I wanted to try asking questions instead of answering them. And so I got my shot to host Fox and Friends, which just so happened to be a disastrous first weekend of hosting Fox and Friends, which I can tell the story of if I need to.
Please.
But, that was
the day. Go ahead, tell the story. We have a few minutes.
Real quick. If you Google my name and axe throwing, you will find it on the internet. But imagine the clickbait that was this viral moment that went internationally viral to include all the morning shows and all the late night shows and everything. Fox News host hits West Point drummer with an axe live on television. Okay, that's the clickbait. And it happened. And it was, you know, totally accidental. And thank God he wasn't hurt. But ultimately, I threw an axe in a competition. It went over the target. And of course, as a lieutenant, I should know never to shoot at anything where I don't know what's behind it. But it was all such a rush that I was doing what the producers were asking me to do. It went over the top of the target. Little did I know is that the West Point Drumline Band was behind the target and it ricocheted off the ground. This is a real double-sided competition axe. It hit off the concrete, it ricocheted into the arm of the drummer. Thank God to this day that it was the handle that hit him, not the blade. And to the credit of that drumline, It was just like the Revolutionary War. The one drummer went down and the other three kept drumming straight in line like he'd been hit and down. It was quite impressive. But, you know, so there was a firestorm around that. But I learned every day, and thank goodness he's okay and everything worked out all right. But nothing ever goes the way you want it to. You just have to take advantage of the of everything in front of you. I never thought I'd be in TV. But ultimately, if you're authentic, passionate, you know something about a topic, that's what I tried to leverage.
So, well, we got some questions in advance. One of the questions is, what would you or where would you recommend someone start looking for a job in the news and media industry, and how would you get your foot in the door? And I guess outside of throwing an axe and missing the target, you know, what advice, you know, let's assume I was coming out, right? You know, or younger version of me, right? So maybe I'm 30 years old, I've been in the Navy for 12 years, I enlisted, and then, you know, I've got a great wife and kids, and I went back to school, but now I really want to focus on media, right? Want to, you know, people tell me I might look okay, might be a good spokesperson for something. How, what advice would you give me, or the hypothetical me, about how to begin a career like that?
Well, you're probably, my advice would be, you're probably not going to start out getting paid for doing what you're doing. So commit to the fact that whatever you're going to need to do to pay the bills, you're going to need to do, and you're going to need to carve out time to create content. It's all about content. So if you want to, there's the traditional way you can go to be both on camera and a producer, which is the local route, which is still, the local news is still thriving and growing. Even though other parts of TV are struggling, oftentimes local news is still robust. Because people want that local flavor. It doesn't pay much. You're a one-man band, basically. But all the producers we have at Fox and Friends, most of them, almost all of them, came from local news. You know, running the nightly news, running the 5 o'clock, running reporters. And the reporters we have, many of them came from that as well, doing their own stand-ups, running out night after night after night, covering stories at the local level. It's a young woman's game often, but it doesn't have to be. There's people that jump into it later in life. You just have to be prepared to put the time in. Unless you've been a PAO or you've done that combat camera in the military, you probably don't have the technical skills you're going to need right away. So you're going to have to eat a little bit of a humble pie, start at the bottom of the rung, work your tail off and show that you can do it. Listen, it's deadlines, it's pressure, it's accuracy, all the things you know in the military, you just have to be able to translate. And then a passion for news, a passion for policy, a passion for entertainment. So local is a one way to go. The other way, which is really exploded recently, is if you want to be on air or you want to be a commentator, create content. And there's so many platforms to create content and sort of build an organic audience that old line news agencies, and I call Fox old line, I don't mean it that way. I mean, they got Fox Nation and all these other newer upbeat streaming services we're working on, but networks or traditional TV oftentimes look around and say, wow, that person has, you know, 100,000 views on a video, really smart opinions. Let's bring he or she on the show to comment. And then they get on one show and it's like, whoa, they were gangbusters. Who is this guy? Who is this gal? Let's use her again. And then one show sees another show and then the ratings are good for that. And then another person. So it can happen pretty quickly that, but it is very much a field of dreams scenario. If you build it, they will come. And you have to put the content out there. Instagram videos, YouTube channels. It's usually not just Twitter, like just blowing people up on, it's because of a different level content. Yeah. Podcasting is another one, or writing op-eds. Some people are writers. Op-eds, you see a lot of journalists and reporters who become on air people because they write so thoughtfully that people say, hey, I want to interview them on that as well. So it's a content game, which you probably won't get paid for right away, but it's a much more small D democratic media world now. You can get access to it if you're good.
Yeah, so a couple things I think came out of that, because I think this applies to many other jobs and industries beyond media. One of them is, particularly if you were reasonably senior in the military, one of the things that people struggle with when they come to us is the ego. I used to be really important, and now I have to do the 11 o'clock. You know, in your case, you mentioned the 11 o'clock shot, you know, it could have been 3 a.m. shot, right?
Sure. And I've done that too.
Yeah, exactly. And so when I talk to people who are coming out of business school and fancy schools and all the rest, they want to be bankers. They said, okay, I'm going to work really hard. What else do I need to do to succeed? I said, you have to say yes. And it doesn't matter what the question is. right? You got to lose that ego. So if the managing director is working with you at 10 o'clock and he says, hey, would you mind getting me a cup of coffee? The answer is yes. Now, it doesn't have to be yes, sir, and you don't have to act like a robot. But people want and will help sponsor those who they get along with. And sometimes, you know, we have some 1 and 3-star generals in our program. They have a hard time even putting their own schedule together, let alone thinking about taking a step back. You know, they don't respond to emails. They don't know how to use. We had this situation not that long ago. We had a 3-star. Sure. He doesn't do his own calendar. His wife does it for him because he always had an aide do it. He doesn't know how to do that. So part of it is putting the ego away and part of it's working. Listen, I want to shift gears for a little bit because you've been really, really generous with your time. But I would like to talk about this book. And for those of you who haven't, let me see. I'm trying to do it so you can all see it on the camera. It's a really, really great book. There are, and the nice thing about it, which I really like, is it's short. And the chapters are, you know, really succinct stories. So, you know, digestible. You can read one chapter, go to bed. You can, you know, it's almost beach season. So you can read it on the beach, wherever you are, but particularly on a plane. So there are 15 great stories in this book. And let's just digress for a minute because it's all about guys and women who you've served with or know of or, you know, really proud to be associated with. Are there one or two great stories in this book that you just like to highlight for us for a moment?
Yeah, I mean, you could highlight all of them, amazing men and women in there. A couple of them real quick. One of them is Nick Irving, who I didn't know before we started the project. His nickname is The Reaper. And he was one of the first black snipers in the 75th Ranger Regiment. And he talks about a little bit of what he confronted. A lot of it is sort of the softer prejudice of sort of being the one or only guy in this elite unit who's a black sniper. And most of it was wonderful, but there's always those subtle places where he felt, didn't quite fit in, but proved himself on the battlefield immensely, earning the nickname The Reaper because he was such a proficient sniper. In particular on one deployment where he logged the highest number of enemy killed of anyone ever in the Army Rangers. So he's sort of historic in the idea of earning the nickname The Reaper. But he's also, I don't know, maybe I've just met him for a Fox Nation shoot, you know, 5'8", you know, maybe 130 pounds soaking wet, but he's an absolute killer. And he talks about coming home and what it meant to put the Reaper away. How do you, there's this caricature, this characterization of who he is and what he's all about. And he needed to, for his family, for his wife, everything, find a way to be, you know, Nick Irving. And he's found it in writing books and doing other things that he's still doing so well today. But we did on Fox Nation, we do a series called Modern Warriors, which is where the book came from. And we did a shooting competition with Nick and I was out there and, you know, I'm just a rifle platoon leader. I'm out there plunking away a little bit. For 2.5 minutes, Nick Irving blinked twice. He blinked twice in 2.5 minutes while picking out targets and smoked us all. There were 2 Navy SEALs, another Army Ranger, and me. And he shot circles around us. Amazing guy, amazing chapter. And then the other one is Eric Garrissey. He's a sergeant major, he retired as a sergeant major, but he was my first sergeant in Iraq. So there's only one guy in the book that I highlighted who I served with on the battlefield. But he's just a soldier. He was my first sergeant. He was not a friendly guy. He did not say nice things to his platoon leaders, and it was a good thing. I knew because I came into the unit a little bit later, and you didn't earn his respect until you showed that you were worthy of it. And it wasn't even what happened on our deployment, which is his second. On his third deployment, he was once again a first sergeant, and the combat outpost he was in charge of was attacked 48 hours after they took it over by an Al-Qaeda force of over 200 that greatly outnumbered the men at the combat outpost. And without the 48 hours of preparation that he put those men through, the base would have been overrun. And every one of his men says, without Eric Garrissey, I wouldn't be alive today. And it's because he didn't care about sleep and eating and all these things. He said, the first thing we do is defend this base because they're going to come after us. And he was right. Just an amazing guy who's a friend to this day. So you'll meet just 15 amazing Americans. And I think representative of the type of people that you have at ACP, just, you know, young vets who are looking for the next chapter of their life. And each chapter does talk about how they transition at some level too.
Well, it's a great read. It's fun and it's easy. Recommend it out there for any of you. Father's Day is coming up, so you can always give a hint here and there.
Yes.
Pete, I just want to thank you so much. I've known you for such a long time. This is the first time we've done one of these live streams. So I just want to thank you for being part of our Wednesday webinar. I'd like to thank our great staff, Allie, and the rest who put this together for us. But for those in the audience, those who serve, those who are part of our program, or we're part of our program, we're here to help. If you have questions, if there are things that we can do, if you want to get to know people in another field, if there's anything at all that we could do, we're here to serve you. So on behalf of Pete and the ACP team, thank you all very much for joining us. We'll look forward to seeing you on one of these streams in the upcoming Wednesdays.
Thank you, guys.
Please let us know if we can help. Pete, thanks so much.
Thanks, Sid.
Have a great rest of the day.
Thanks, all.
Okay. Bye-bye.